If you look at the pinout of an op amp, you'll see two pins labeled offset null. That's what I'm going to be talking about here in this video. The offset null is used to adjust something called the offset voltage. It's an imperfection in op amps, and there are certain circumstances where you need to correct for it. First, I'd like to talk about what it is and the problems it causes. Then I'll describe where it originates, and I'll tell you exactly how you can fix it. If we tie the two input pins of an op amp together, we expect the output to be zero. That's what we want from an ideal op amp. A real op amp, though, might not give us exactly 0 volts at the output. That's bad, of course, because in an ideal differential amplifier, you would need to have that output equal to zero if there's no difference between the voltages at the two input pins. We're going to model this imperfection as an offset voltage. You might notice here that I'm drawing a little voltage source there at the input pin of an op amp. This is just a mathematical model of an imperfection that's inside the op amp. What we're doing here is modeling the imperfection as an input voltage that's required to zero the output. In other words, when you go to use the op amp in an actual circuit, you're going to find that the output voltage is not exactly zero, even if the two input pins are tied to one another. However, if you were to put a little bit of voltage between the two input pins and adjust it to the appropriate value, you might be able to zero it out. That's what we're modeling right here. With the appropriate VOS, we can force the output to be equal to zero. That's the definition of the offset voltage. Now I'm going to talk about the effect of this offset voltage on some actual circuits. First, let's look at an inverting amplifier. This is a standard configuration, and I'm going to first assume that the op amp is offset free. In other words, it's basically an ideal op amp. With an input voltage of 10 millivolts, let's find the output voltage. If everything is perfect, you might recall that the gain is just this resistance divided by this resistance. So we expect the gain to be 100 here, but I'm going to go through the derivation because we won't be able to make that assumption in the next view graph. Because this pin is grounded, it's at 0 volts. Because of the negative feedback, we expect this voltage also to be 0 volts. Because the op amp is offset free, I then expect this voltage also to be 0 volts. I'd like to label this current I1 and this current I2. Although I'll later be assuming that the op amp is not quite perfect, I'm still going to assume that we're not eating up any of that current at the input pin of the op amp. In other words, I'm going to assume that I1 equals I2. We can use Ohm's law across the source resistor to find I1. We have 10 millivolts at this side, and we have 0 volts at the other side. We can also use Ohm's law across the feedback resistor RF in order to find I2. We have 0 volts on the left side of it, and we have the output voltage on the right side of it. Let's bring the 100 up here to the left half of the equation, and we're left with minus V out over there at the right. The output voltage is just -1 volts. Since the input voltage was 10 millivolts, I can conclude that the gain was -100. That's exactly what we expect by looking at these two resistors in this circuit. Of course, this circuit contained an op amp that was offset free. What I'm going to do now is assume that we have the same circuit, the same amplifier, but we have an op amp that's not offset free. How will that affect the gain? We're going to assume an offset voltage of 4 millivolts. It's still a pretty good op amp, but it's not perfect. How will this 4 millivolts affect our gain? Well, this pin is grounded, so it's at 0 volts. Because of the negative feedback, this voltage should also be 0 volts. However, because the op amp is not offset free, we're going to have 4 millivolts at this node. Just as I did with the last problem, I'm going to label this current I1, and I'm going to label this current as I2. I1 is just going to be equal to I2, and we can use Ohm's law in order to find both of these currents. We need to apply V over R for R sub S in order to find I1. We have 10 millivolts to the left and 4 millivolts to the right. So there's our delta V, and our resistance here is 1K. For I2, I see that we have 4 millivolts to the left of the resistor, and we have our output voltage V out to the right. The resistance here is 100K. Let's move the 100K to the left side of this equation. The 1,000 cancels out, and we're just left with 100 here. We have 600 millivolts on the left side of this equation. So when I subtract the 4 millivolts on the right, we wind up with 596 millivolts, and that's equal to minus V out. Since our input voltage was just 10 millivolts, I can conclude that our gain is 59.6. If we just look at the two resistors, 100 kiloohms and 1 kiloohms, we might conclude that the magnitude of the gain ought to be 100, but the gain that we just found out is only 59.6. Therefore, the magnitude of the gain has been reduced, and the reason it's been reduced is because of the presence of that imperfection in our op amp. That imperfection originates during the fabrication of the op amp. So the op amp is kind of a complicated amplifier. It doesn't just have a single transistor inside of it. It has a number of different transistors. And anytime you fabricate something lithographically using silicon, you're going to have variations from component to component. To make a very good differential amplifier, you need to have these components very well matched, and that can't always be done perfectly. This is mainly due to doping variations, lithographic errors. There can be packaging and stress issues as well. Now, I'm showing an example circuit over here on the right. Now, this is not an op amp. It's just a very simple differential amplifier because I want to illustrate why the component mismatch can cause an offset. Here we have two MOSFETs, two resistors, and I'm assuming that things are biased down here with the current source. Since this is a differential amplifier, it should amplify any difference at the input pin. So I'm just going to tie these two input pins together so that there's no difference to multiply at all. In this situation, the output voltage ought to be zero. Let's consider why it ought to be zero if these two MOSFETs are well matched. From the biasing consideration, we can see that both of these amplifiers have the same source voltage. Because they also have the same gate voltage, due to the fact that we've tied these two input pins together, then they have the same gate source voltage. Because they have the same gate source voltage, they should have the same amount of current passing down into their drain. With the same amount of current passing down through their drain, that current has to go through these two resistors, and if they're well matched, that is, if R1 equals R2, the output ought to be zero because the voltage here ought to equal the voltage here. Now let's talk about what might make that not work. Why might the output voltage not be zero? Well, if R1 is not perfectly matched to R2, the voltages are not going to be equal to one another because even if these two currents are the same, the voltage drop across resistor R1 won't be exactly the same as the voltage drop across R2 unless the resistors are equal to one another. So the mismatch in resistances can cause a problem. But I hope you would take note that any mismatch in the MOSFETs would also result in a change in the voltage. Even if the gate source voltages in these two MOSFETs are the same, some small variation in conditions from one MOSFET to another might then cause the drain current for MOSFET M1 to be slightly different from the drain current of MOSFET M2. Therefore, even if resistor R1 were hypothetically well matched to resistor R2, we still might have a non-zero output voltage due to problems inside the MOSFETs here. So this is just meant to give you some idea of where an offset voltage might originate in the design of an amplifier. Of course, we hope that doesn't happen, but it can't be completely avoided. All other things being equal, the problem tends to be worse in devices using MOSFETs compared to devices using bipolar junction transistors. So with bipolar junction transistors, you might end up with offset voltages on the order of a few hundred microvolts. But with CMOS, you might end up with something that's 10 to 100 times worse. It's more difficult to match things in MOSFETs than it is to match things in BJTs. Let's take a look at a few more circuits to get some idea of the kinds of effects that the offset voltage can cause, and then I'll show you how to fix it. Let's first look at two amplifiers that you're probably already familiar with, a non-inverting amplifier and an inverting amplifier. In order to isolate the effect of the offset voltage, let's first look at it when the input is just connected to ground. That is, we're not going to amplify any signal at all. Under this scenario, we would expect that the output voltage be 0 volts for both of these amplifiers. What we're going to do next, though, is to insert the offset voltage, or our mathematical model of it, into both of these circuits in order to see what the output voltage would be due to the offset voltage. So where am I going to put it in these circuits? We could insert the offset voltage in front of either pin, but for consistency here, I'm going to put it at the non-inverting pin in both of these circuits. Of course, we no longer expect the output to be at 0 volts. Our job now is to find out what it is. If you look for a moment at these two circuits, I hope you'll realize that the circuits are now exactly the same. Look at the non-inverting pin of the circuit here on the right. It's exactly the same as what we have connected to the pin here for the circuit on the left. Likewise, we have resistor R2 providing feedback between the output and the inverting pin. That's exactly what we have over here as well. Finally, we have resistor 1 connected to ground. That's what we have here as well. Since the two circuits are exactly the same, I only need to do the analysis once. Let's go ahead and proceed with that analysis in order to determine the output voltage. I've simplified the circuit drawing just a little bit to get us started, but this circuit, again, represents both the inverting and the non-inverting amplifier when we're isolating the effect of the offset voltage. This pin is grounded, so it's at 0 volts. The voltage here is then VOS. Because of the negative feedback and the amplifier being well behaved, we would also expect this voltage to be VOS. Let's label this current I1 and this current I2. We know that I1 ought to equal I2, and we can use Ohm's law to find both of these currents. We have 0 volts to the left and VOS to the right. There's V over R for I1. Now let's do V over R for I2. We have VOS to the left and VO to the right. Let's get rid of the 0 and move the R2 over to the left side of the equation. Let's now solve this for the output voltage. What we've just found is that the output voltage is some constant value times the offset voltage. And if you look at the constant here that's multiplied times the offset voltage, you'll see that it's 1 plus R2 over R1. So it's always a number that's greater than 1. That might not be a problem if the signal that you're trying to amplify when you use the op amp is not a very small signal, but that's not always true. Sometimes the reason why you're using an op amp in a circuit is precisely because you want to amplify a small signal. If the signal that you're trying to amplify when you use the op amp is a fairly large signal to start with, then this may not be much of a problem. But quite often, the reason why you've chosen an op amp, a differential amplifier that is, to start with, is because you're precisely trying to amplify a very small signal. So if your small signal that you're trying to amplify is very close in magnitude to the offset voltage itself, then you could have a problem. We'll see how to fix that here in just a moment, but first let's look at another circuit. Here I'm showing both the differentiator and the integrator circuit, and I've talked about both of these circuits in another video. If we wanted to find the effect of the offset voltage on the performance of either of these circuits, how would I do it? Well, the first thing that I would do would be to include the mathematical model of the offset voltage here in our circuit diagrams. There we go. I've put it right in front of the non-inverting pin. In order now to isolate the effect of the offset voltage on the output voltage, I would ground our input. Since I'm modeling the offset voltage here as a perfect voltage source, and because that's a linear circuit element, the results that I'm calculating now are entirely accurate, even if I have something connected to the input of either of these two amplifiers. You might recall that you can use superposition when you're dealing with linear sources. Let's now determine the effect of the offset voltage on the integrator. We can leave the differentiator for another time. I've redrawn the circuit here just a little bit, but basically we just need to find the output voltage in terms of VOS. Because this voltage is VOS, we also know that this voltage is going to be VOS as well. Let's label the voltage across the capacitor as V, and I'm going to label the current here as I1 and the current through the capacitor as I2. Let's recall how current and voltage are related in a capacitor. The current equals C times the derivative of the voltage across the capacitor. In this particular circuit, the voltage V is just the offset voltage minus the output voltage. As we've done in previous derivations, I'm going to say I1 equals I2 because I'm neglecting any current that might be going into the non-inverting pin here. Applying Ohm's law across R, I find 0 volts to the left, VOS to the right, and we have a resistance of R. For I2, I'm going to copy the equation that I've just derived. Let's now multiply both sides of this equation by negative R. Since I'm trying to solve for the output voltage and it's inside of a derivative, I'm going to integrate with respect to time in order to get it out of there. If we assume that the offset voltage is constant, then the integral here on the left is just VOS times time. RC is just a constant over here on the right. Let's divide both sides of this equation by RC. And finally, I can solve for the output voltage VO. I think you're very quickly going to understand why I chose the integrating circuit in particular to demonstrate the effect of the offset voltage. It's really bad. Take a look at this equation. You can see that the output voltage equals some constant plus the offset voltage times time. As the time increases, the output voltage just gets higher and higher and higher. There's no bound to it. Therefore, a small problem, the offset voltage can grow over time with the integrating circuit. It could quickly cause the amplifier to saturate, in other words. So you might say that if you need to use the integrating circuit, you might need to give more attention to the offset voltage than you would in other types of circuits. That now brings us almost to the conclusion of the video. How do you fix the problem? Well, the problem itself is not very mysterious, and we know what causes it. So when they put these op amps on chips, they actually present pins in order to fix the problem. These two pins, as I mentioned at the start of the video, are called the offset null pins. There's one of them on pin 1, and there's another one here on pin 5. If you're just using the op amp, and you don't care about the offset null, or you don't care about being so precise, then you can just ignore these pins, and there's no need to hook them up to anything. But if you want to fix the problem with the offset null, you can do the following. You can hook a potentiometer or a variable resistor in between pin 1 and pin 5, then hook the wiper to the minus VCC, monitor the output voltage while applying 0 volts at the input, and adjust the wiper of the potentiometer until the output reads 0 volts. That will give you a very easy and clear way to fix the problems with the offset voltage.